starting there in verse 18 and down through the end of the chapter and the end of the epistle. First John chapter 5, verse 18. We know that whosoever is born of God sinneth not. But he that is begotten of God keepeth himself, and that wicked one toucheth him not. And we know that we are of God, and the whole world lieth in wickedness. And we know that the Son of God is come, and hath given us an understanding, that we may know him that is true, and we are in him that is true, even in his Son, Jesus Christ. This is the true God and eternal life. Little children, keep yourselves from idols. Amen. Let's go ahead and pray. Father in heaven, Lord, I love you. Lord, I ask your blessing upon the service tonight. Lord, I pray that you'd fill me with your Spirit. I pray that you would control, Lord, what I say and how I say it. I pray that you meet the needs that are here in this room. Lord, if there's any among us who has not truly been converted, Lord, I certainly pray for that tonight, for your conviction and the drawing of your Spirit upon that heart and life. Father, for those of us who have been converted and know Christ as our Savior, I pray that you'd use this tonight to strengthen us, help us in this midweek service. I'm certain that there's just multitudes here facing just different battles from different angles. And Lord, there's simply no way that I could possibly know all that is going on and meet those needs. But I certainly know that your Spirit can. So I'm certainly asking for your help, Lord. I love you. I pray and ask all this in Christ's name. Amen. Well, as we conclude 1 John, again, I certainly have enjoyed this. There's been some amazing truths that we have looked at. Of course, as we start from the very first message of this and looking at John himself, how he was referred to as a son of thunder, how things were very black and white. There's no gray areas with John, especially when it comes to the Lord Jesus Christ. People like to try and create gray areas when it comes to the doctrine of Christ. That's just never right. As John laid out here over and over and over throughout this book, it's either black or it's white. It's either wrong or it's right. You're in one of those camps. And they had the problem of the Gnosticism that had come in. They had bad doctrine about who Jesus Christ was. And that was leading to different sins because of their view of Christ. What you think of Christ is very, very important. And so he starts that off back in chapter 1. We are looking at the very doctrine of Christ, that this was, in fact, the Son of God come in the flesh, that this just wasn't any other man, but that this was the Christ, the Son of God, and he was, in fact, in the flesh. We looked at how he was the propitiation for our sins and all the work that he does. We looked at how this is the key to the joy in the Christian life. We were seeing as it developed where our love should be as a Christian, how the importance of having love for the brethren, how that was another indicator for those who were truly born again. Remember, he was laying out chapter after chapter marks of those who are truly converted. What marks your conversion is not simply that you prayed a prayer. The evidence that comes after conversion is very important. And that's what he was laying out here. So those in those churches there in Asia Minor don't have a clue. Wait a minute, we have problems here. We have unconverted people that are right in our midst. And so we are looking at, and he also dealt with our love, where our love should not be, where it should not be in the world. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. And he was, again, stressing that. And again, it's just been an amazing book. I've certainly have enjoyed it. I have the privilege of getting to study it each week before I come here. But I've enjoyed it. As we're concluding here, John is going back to a key word. He's actually, the last several verses here, he has used it, and that is the word no. It's used 39 times in this epistle, or at least some variant of it is. And he's finishing up with three things that we need to know as he's concluding this as born-again child of God. When I was in high school, I would say probably one of my favorite classes was geometry. I enjoyed the challenge of geometry I can't remember all the terminology nowadays, but in trying to figure out those different triangles and the sides and the distance. And I remember when you were being taught it, you were given different axioms that if these things were true, you knew how to act. You knew how to solve the equation. All right. And it basically taught you deductive reasoning. Well, right here, he is basically doing the same thing. He's giving us some things that are true, which is a starting point for us on where we can go because we know these things. that those who are of God, we know these things, and so there's some implications and some truths as a result of that, and that's what we're going to look at right now. And again, when you think back to the problems that were going on in all these churches at the end of the first century where John is writing, they were off in the doctrine of Christ, and because of that, it led to wrong conclusions. Remember what a lot of the Gnostics were doing at this time. They did not believe what? That Christ was in the flesh. All right? He couldn't have had a real body. And so that fed all types of bad doctrine. They believed the flesh was wicked of itself. And they were separating sort of the spiritual from the flesh to a very wrong degree. They were indulging their flesh. They would go off to the in Ephesus there. They would head off to the temple of Diana, and they could go be with the prostitutes that were there. That was of the flesh. It was all right. That flesh is wicked. There's nothing we can do about it. That's what it was leading to, their wrong doctrine. When you have wrong doctrine in place, it's going to give you wrong conclusions. It's why it's important that you really do know this book. That's why there's such confusion going church after church after church, is because what they're making decisions based on might not be based on truth. It just might be based on what the next church is doing instead of truth. But we have to respond out of truth. Your life will be a whole lot easier when the decisions you make for your family is actually based upon truth. So what he does do here, he gives us three things that we need to know. And I'm going to break these down into this: knowing the conduct of the converted one, secondly, the position of the converted one, and thirdly, the key to understanding for those who have been converted. All right? So first off, though, let's go back here to our very first verse, and we're going to look at the conduct of those who are converted. Verse 18, we know that whosoever is born of God sinneth not. But he that is begotten of God keepeth himself, and that wicked one toucheth him not. So again, here we're going to see the conduct of one who is converted. And this is now the third time, and matter of fact, each of the things we're looking at, as John does in this epistle, he stresses things and repeats them over and over so that we'll have down these truths. And this is the third time he is addressing the issue how those who are born of God sinneth not. It's not, of course, dealing with perfection. You're dealing with the word that's in that continuous present tense. It's dealing with the action of the practice of sin over and over and over and over. When a Christian is converted, their view of sin absolutely changes. If you claim a conversion to Christ and your view of sin does not change, something is drastically wrong. For the Christian, for the converted, does it make you perfect? I heard one preacher put it like this: it's not talking about perfection, it's talking about direction. Now all of a sudden you want to take your life in a new direction. Does it mean you're not going to struggle with the flesh? You absolutely will struggle with the flesh. I mean, if we look at what he was just dealing with before, we realize the reality of Christians struggling in the flesh. Last week we talked about the sin unto death. So Christians certainly are going to struggle with that. So this, again, it's dealing with the idea of a Christian practicing sin over and over. A Christian will have a different view on sin. He's not going to be perfect, but he does have a desire and power to turn from it. All of a sudden after conversion, basically what you have taken place now is a battle that just intensifies to another level within yourself, because the flesh is still there. The flesh is still strong. We can go back to Romans chapter 6 and 7 to break this much more out doctrinally of what we're dealing with. But the flesh is still there and it's still strong. You're still going to have, you're now going to have a battle that's going to be taking place. It's kind of like this. When I was in New Guinea, pigs were everywhere. And those really are some nasty animals. So those pigs would go, we'd have those enormous downpours of the rain, and it would just create mud everywhere. Well, a pig will go right up to that mud pit, and he'll just dive right in it and just stay there. He'll just, what's that, wallow in it? What's the word I'm looking for? Just, you know, over and over. It's just nasty as anything. Now, take a sheep. Maybe he's playing around with that mud pit, and he falls into that thing. That sheep's going to want to get out. He has a different nature than that pig. You see, because of your flesh, you might be drawn to sin. You can still be drawn away of your own lust and tempted. You can even get to the point, obviously, that temptation becomes sin in your life. But for the difference for those who are converted, is when they fall in the pit, they want out. They want out. If you want to live in that pit, listen, you need to check your salvation. You need to check your salvation. If you are just content to wallow in that mud and the filth of this world and it doesn't bother you, you're missing something. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. All right? So the conduct of the converted is he doesn't desire to live in that sin. He's still going to struggle with the flesh. And we also have help in this verse, even with what Christ has given us through our conversion and keeping us. He just doesn't leave us to the devil. He just doesn't leave us. Matter of fact, the devil is limited on how he can attack and tempt a Christian, those who have been born again. And when that verse finishes, what does it say there? And that wicked one toucheth him not. Now, we know the devil certainly can't tempt us. We know he's certainly going to try to. We know he's still going to act as a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. And no doubt he will try and set you up like a chessboard. But the great thing about being saved is the most powerful weapon in his arsenal he can't use against us. He cannot lay hold on us. He can't do it. God does not allow it. That's one of the reasons why you don't want to stay wallowed up in all the mud and the filth of this world. As we have an advantage being a Christian through the Lord Jesus Christ. So the conduct of the converted is he sinneth not. He no longer has the idea where he wants to practice and live in the filth of this world. It becomes a battle for him to stay away from that. Now, next, we have the position of the converted. Let's look at verse 19 there. Here's the second no. All right, and we know, now this is great, isn't it, that we are of God and that the whole world lieth in wickedness. As a result of our conversion, we are now of God. We have been translated, according to Colossians 1 and verse 13, into a whole nother kingdom, into a whole nother realm now we have been translated into. Our position changed. At the very moment when I was hearing the gospel and I made the decision to repent and put my faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, I was translated into the kingdom of his dear son. I became of God at that moment in time. And of course, this world, which is controlled by Satan, who is the prince and power of the air, it lieth in wickedness. It really is a horrible description of the despair that this world is in. And for the most part, they don't even see it. They don't even see it. This world lieth in wickedness. Listen, the devil knows what he's doing. We know in 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Turn over to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. I want to look at just a few things of what the devil is doing in this world. Here's what he's doing in this world right now. We're going to look at just three things here that he's doing. First one here is in 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 4. In whom the god of this world, which would be Satan, hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. He is busy blinding the minds of those who are lost. Listen, there has never been a day in American history when that is more evident than right now. You can see the blindness that are in the minds. I mean, just a few days ago, we had mothers marching for the right to kill their own unborn children. That's called blinded. They're completely blinded to the absurdity of that, to the reality of the murder that is taking place. They've been blinded. We live in a culture now when it's perfectly acceptable to choose whatever gender you feel like. If Rob Wright wants to decide that he's a woman, he can be a woman now. I was watching a clip. This preacher is doing a really good job. He's at a university. He wanted to challenge this notion that you can choose whatever you want to be. So he starts off the typical question. He was polling college students, and honestly, I'm not trying to be mean. The ignorance, the stupidity was enormous. It was crazy. And he said, so if I want to be a woman, I can be a woman. And several of them said, oh, yes, absolutely, you could be. That's just fine. You know, it's not hurting anybody. He said, that's interesting. He said, I want to be an Asian woman. Can I be an Asian woman? And they paused for a few more seconds, but they realized what they just agreed to. They had better stay consistent. And they said, that's fine. If you think you're an Asian woman, I remember one lady saying, just more power to you. That's good. You're an Asian woman. And he is about my height. He was probably 5'8", 5'9". And he said, I want to be a 6'5" Asian woman. That's what I think I am. He said, am I a 6'5" Asian woman? Well, that gave more pause. And they finally concluded, if that's what you think you are, that's just fine. You're a 6'5" Asian woman. He said, but wait, not only do I want to be a 6'5" Asian woman, I really only want to be 7 years old. And then what he really got him thinking, he said, once they agreed, that's fine. If that's what you believe, more power to you. And then he said, but now I want to attend the first grade. Now danger flags went off in their mind. And you can see a much greater pause. To some of them now said, no, that I might have a problem with. Yeah, it's not consistent. What they don't realize is they should have had a problem at the very beginning when you're going against biology. And what we need to do is to be a help to those people and let them know, no, something is wrong with your thinking. You're not a woman. You were born a man, and that's exactly what you are. And it would not be loving, it would not be kind for us to play some political game with you to let you believe otherwise. So what's going on? The devil's at work. He is blinding the minds. And what we're going to see, understand how this works. This has been true since the book of Genesis. Truth is illuminated by God. And our culture is getting farther and farther away from God, so they don't have problems with things. They don't have problems. This world is even blind to the fact of a creator himself. I mean, literally, looking out at this amazing universe and concluding, some of the most brilliant minds of our day, that nothing created everything. Exactly. It's incredible the blindness that is there. Everything you look at in creation screams, Creator! But they are blinded to it. They're blinded to it. Completely blinded to it. Now, as you look over in Luke chapter 8, look in Luke chapter 8. We're just going to read one verse. We're not going to go through all the parable of the sower, but I do want to show you something else that the devil is very active at doing, and we need to keep this in mind as we're out in this world. Verse 12. Those by the wayside, the seed that was sown, those by the wayside are they that hear, then cometh the devil and taketh away the word out of their hearts, lest they should believe and be saved. Make no doubt about it, as we are being the salt and light in this world, and we are giving the gospel out, please don't be ignorant of the devil's devices. He is going to be coming in right away and do what he can to try and get that out of the heart. That's why it's so important that when we do sow it, we're trying to sow it with some power, with some compassion, not just running through something, but to sow the seed in the heart. The devil's going to be at work trying his best to take it away. We were talking with a man last night in the domicile, and as we're going through the gospel with him, when we got, after it was all over with, he had said this, and this is, of course, I'll trust the Holy Spirit to work and do the illuminating that's needed there. He said, you know, from the prison system to this, he goes, at times, I'm going to be honest, he didn't know who to believe. I mean, he had mentioned several groups that had come through, whether it was SDA or this-ism or this-ism. that had come through. And of course, the advantage we do have, we'll stay with the gospel and we'll stay with truth, and we're ready to give an answer to those who ask of us of the hope that is in us, and that we're not playing a game with it, that we're seeing the need to effectively present the gospel. We have the Holy Spirit that is going to that person and saying, listen to this, listen to this, listen to this. So we have the devil, he's stealing away the word, stealing away the word that has been sown. Look in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. Verse 18. Wherefore we would have come unto you, even I, Paul, once and again, but Satan hindered us. He absolutely does his best to hinder the work of God. That's what he's all about. He's about hindering the work of God. Now, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Don't get me wrong. I in no way believe that God is up in heaven saying, oh, no, what's he going to do now? All right? I don't think that for, I mean, God is God. He is the all-powerful, almighty God. At the same time, Satan's work here, though, is to hinder that. We need to be able to recognize that as we're trying to serve the Lord, as we're trying to be right before God with our families, as we're trying to live right before this world, as we're trying to get the gospel out to this world, to recognize, listen, there's other things at work here. And they are designed to try and hinder God's work from going forward. Listen, he doesn't do that at some grand scale with our church. He does it in our individual lives. Listen, all of us, we can lay this foundation out in the book of Corinthians. We all have a role to play in the work of God. And if the devil has you distracted away from it, something's not being done. Something's not being done. But I am so glad that I am of God as the result of my conversion. There's a responsibility to this position. Again, a responsibility that includes us being salt and light. A responsibility that as we're living in this world and as we head to work tomorrow, that we are living the Christian life, where it's more than a bumper sticker on your vehicle. And when they know that when you speak of the compassion that's there in your voice, where they begin to recognize, you know, maybe he does have what I need. There's a responsibility. This whole world lieth in what? In wickedness. It lieth in wickedness. And at my conversion, I was taken out of that mess. But you know what? There's people in these houses right here. They're still in it. They're still there. They're having to live in a world that lieth in wickedness. And the more you're distracted, the less likely they are to hear. The world lieth in wickedness. They're trying to operate apart from truth. That always ends in failure. 100% of the time, it ends in failure. I went to a list. I tried to research on the internet for the sermon this week, a list of those who were incredibly successful at whatever they did and yet committed suicide. The list was astronomical, of course. It was astronomical. I wrote down just a few of the names. Prince Alfred Edwards, member of the royal family, shot himself in 1899. Edwin Armstrong in 1954, he was the inventor of the FM radio. The American author, very successful, James Baker. Kurt Cobain, the American rock star, who committed suicide in the early 90s. It was at the top of pinnacle of his career when that took place. George Eastman, the 1932 inventor, and a well-known, he was known to give his money out to great causes to support mankind, and yet he committed suicide. Ernest Hemingway, Robin Williams. There was a list of just successful businessmen who had made millions and millions. And there was a list of them who committed suicide. What was happening? What they were trying to live for, they were trying to operate of life under the sun. Apart from God, it always fails. It always fails. I had an uncle who I was named after last Friday. And he took his own life. He was a Vietnam veteran. I remember on a furlough trying to talk with him. And he wanted nothing to do with God. Nothing. He didn't have time for that. Now he doesn't have time for that. Now he doesn't. There are people in this world who are trying to find meaning in their career, in their relationships, in leisure, in recreation. They're living in a world that lieth in wickedness. And here's what gets me aggravated, is we have Christians trying to live for the same goals. They think the pig wallowing in the mud is somehow a good thing. You know what the good thing is? I have the best thing I've ever received. I was translated into the kingdom of his dear son. I am of God. How could I not live but to that end? Thirdly, this is great too. Really good stuff. Back in 1 John. Here's the third thing and the last thing that he gives us that we know as Christians. And we know that the Son of God is come. Now get this, he's not finished with this thought yet. And hath given us an understanding that we may know him that is true. And we are in him that is true. Even his Son, Jesus Christ. This is the true God and eternal life. Another thing that I know is because of conversion, because of being of God, that opens the door to my understanding about God. I can begin even right now in the sinful flesh that I have. And still with the wicked mind that I still possess and the battles that we all battle with our flesh every day. Yet through his grace and his mercy, where sin did abound, grace did much more abound. That I can begin to have an understanding of the all-knowing, almighty God. I can now begin to understand truths about him. Remember, this is key, and the principle is throughout the Word of God. Truth is always given by illumination, and God responds to the character of the person when he's illuminating truth. Remember what he said about Capernaum, Jesus Christ? When he was talking about how they had rejected him, how more miracles were done there than anywhere else. And then he went off praying to the Father, and he made a point saying that how God did not illuminate it unto them because of their pride, their arrogance. See, God responds to us with understanding based on who we are. We have the privilege of getting an understanding to know God. What is it? 1 Corinthians 2:14. What is that? Let me go there. I don't know why I can't quote that right now. It deals with how you're... Let me just go there and read it real quick. You don't have to turn there if you don't want to. I'll be there in just a second. Yeah, for the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him, neither can he know them because they are spiritually discerned. When I got saved, it enabled me to gain an understanding about God. Listen, I have his revealed word right here that he's going to be using. All right? As truth about who he is revealed. So I want you to think about that. As you're blowing off your devotion tomorrow, you're going to blow off that devotion tomorrow, what you're missing is an opportunity to gain a further understanding of who God is. Or if you're going to have it and you're just going to check your box and you're just going to, all right, I did my duty. You know, when Marianne and I were in high school, and she would hand me those notes in the hallways we passed, which I have all of them. I really do need to throw those things away. Really do. Actually, I'm going to regret that one day, keeping all those notes. But she would hand me those notes. I could not wait to read them. I learned of her through that. And here I learn of God. I learn of him. I see his long suffering throughout the Bible. His mercy and his grace. I see his hatred for sin and his desire for holiness. I see the amazing love that he has demonstrated for me throughout the Word of God. And because of conversion, I have the key to understanding him. I have the key to understanding him. Now, it appears that he throws one last thing out of us out of nowhere, but that is not the case at all. Well, let me cover one more thing here. I don't want to skip that at all. Before I get to that very last thing here, and I'll be done, two things I need to discuss here. One is I'm finishing up on verse 19. We have one of the greatest proclamations of the deity of Jesus Christ that is given. Again, understand that John has understood that the very deity of Christ was being attacked. And he gives us one of the greatest statements we have in the conclusion of verse 20. That we may know him that is true, and we are in him that is true, even his Son, Jesus Christ. This is the true God and eternal life. How you could be a Jehovah's Witness and deny the deity? Well, that's actually talking about God the Father who was brought up before. No, that no way flows in any grammar structure. It has to be referring to the most recent subject given, which is Jesus Christ. Or the Mormons who deny who Jesus is. Listen, why is that so important to the devil? Because when you are off on Christ, you will draw wrong conclusions. You are now operating outside of truth. And remember, with truth, there are absolutes. It's a dangerous game to play. But anyway, we have one of the great, you should mark that verse in your Bible. If you come across somebody who does not understand who Jesus Christ is, you have it right there in 1 John 5:20 telling you, this is the true God and eternal life. This was God in the flesh. He forgave sins. He raised the dead. He performed miracles. He accepted worship. Those are all things of the Creator. That is who he was. Now, we get into the final warning here, if you will. It almost appears when you're first reading through this, again, that it's just sort of out of nowhere. It absolutely is not, especially when you consider what 1 John is dealing with from the very beginning, what we've been going through this throughout this whole book, and we're dealing with a lot of those churches in Asia Minor. The key of that city is going to be Ephesus, the third greatest city of its day, with the temple Diana that is there and all the idolatry that was taking place in it. And he certainly did not want them to be swept away because he's just establishing the fact. He's saying, listen, this is the true God. This is the real one. This isn't some idol. This isn't something that's made up. This is the true God. And he stresses the importance of fleeing from idolatry. And we say we don't have to worry about that here in the United States of America. Oh, goodness. Idolatry fills our churches. Fills them. cultures begin to create their own gods to meet their own desires and needs. In America, they've been creating their own gods, the god of mammon, of living for this life, of all that it can offer. Your idol can be anything that takes your focus off of God. That's your idol. Anything that takes your focus off of God is now your idol. It's what you're bowing to. It's what's controlling your life. That's why, look over in Colossians chapter 3. It's actually in the New Testament. I know certain two times, and I think it's three, but I can only think of two times for certain. But look at Colossians chapter 3, verse 5. Mortify therefore your members which are upon the earth, fornication, uncleanness, inordinate affection, evil concupiscence, and covetousness, which is idolatry. Covetousness is a sin. What it does is this. Why covetousness is easily referred to as idolatry? Because it is idolatry. What it does is it steals your focus off of what it should be on. That's what covetousness does. You are coveting something other than God. Your focus has been stolen. It's on something else. Now get this. Here's your danger. Because now, guess what you're doing? You're operating outside of truth. You're operating outside of truth. You are making decisions based on idolatry, not based on a walk with God. You think that'll have consequences in your life? It absolutely will. It absolutely. And not only in your life, in the lives of your children. You know what your children need to see? You know what the key here is to having your children being raised and want to serve God? Where they see a home where it's about Him. Where it's about God. They don't have to see perfect parents. But they have to see parents where it's real. Where it's real. Where there isn't idolatry in the home. Where they're not learning. We go to church, but again, they can't verbalize it this way. You can't even verbalize it this way because you've been ignorant of the devil's devices. But when we go home, we have our own idols. And that's what we bow down to. Your idol can be anything that takes your focus off of God. This can be a career, a pursuit of money, a devotion to leisure and recreation, and on and on and on. It's putting things before God that have no place there. When you begin to examine your heart, you have to examine your heart and ask the Lord, show me if I have idolatry present in my life. Where the Lord is going to take your thoughts is to what you're coveting. He's already done it. Present, I believe he's already working on your heart, and the conviction is there unless you're already hardening your heart. What is it that takes your devotion time? What is it that keeps you from church? What is it that takes up your thought life? I think it would scare us if we saw all the idolatry taking. What role covetousness comes in and steals your focus. And one day, you're going to stand before Him who gave everything for you, who became sin that He might give you His righteousness, that you could stand justified before the Father. The one who gives you the very breath, the air that you're breathing. The reason why your heart is beating there right now is because He's allowing it. Two things we're going to be singing that day, huh? Either I wish I'd given Him more, or what a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. Three things we need to know. With every head bowed.